We are the same people we were biologically about 150,000 years ago when the modern Homo sapiens finished evolving. You may or may not be surprised to know that advances in technology will directly impact our evolutionary path. This is all you need to know to get introduced to transhumanism. Welcome, dear viewer. Today, we'll take a brief look at the concept of transhumanism and how it may affect the human condition soon. If you're new to the channel, please subscribe to Futurephile to watch more fascinating videos on futuristic tech. What is transhumanism? Transhumanism is at its current stage, is merely a philosophy. As a philosophy, it advocates strongly for humans to develop and make widely available sophisticated technologies that enhance human physiology and intellect greatly. In layman's terms, transhumanists would like for human beings to become cyborgs, cybernetic organisms. As such, transhumanist concepts feature greatly in science fiction. Cyborgs are commonly seen in all forms of science fiction media, from DC Comics' aptly named Cyborg to The Terminator and Sergeant Rex Colt in Far City 3, Blood Dragon. They are everywhere in science fiction. Concepts of transhumanism and the wish to improve human physiology beyond normal bounds comes from an age-old human desire. That desire is the desire for immortality. Such wishes have been expressed in literature and rhetoric as far back as the early Bronze Age. It would still take quite some time after the Industrial Revolution for early transhumanist thinking to develop. The fundamental idea that continued to underlie transhumanism were first advanced in 1923 by British geneticist J.B.S. Haldane. He postulated the idea that advanced technology growth could eventually allow humans to accomplish much more than a fully fit natural-born and grown human can. He also correctly states that such advances would be viewed negatively at first, as unnatural and as blasphemy. Focusing his interests, he speculated at length about the effect of such advanced technology to edit human genetics. Such work was speculated by him to lead to improvement to overall health, strength, and intelligence. Extensive development of the concept would be done by J.D. Bernal at first, who speculated on transhumanism working in conjunction with the colonization of space. Afterwards, the biologist Julian Huxley would make what is arguably the most important contribution to the development of transhumanism as a fully-fledged philosophy. In his words, regular human life was nasty, brutish, and short, and that the great majority of human beings have been afflicted with misery. He postulated the idea that if mankind wishes, it can transcend far beyond the limits of his natural human body across the board, all of humanity. Thus, the concept of transhumanism began to actively advocate for technological development that can allow such changes to happen. Transhumanism truly began to grow as a philosophical movement with ever-increasing numbers from the 1980s. One of the main proponents of this was scientist F.M. Esvandiary, who legally changed his name to F.M. 2030. Collaborating with scientist Natasha Vita Moore, he began holding social gatherings for transhumanist thinkers and other people interested in it in Los Angeles. As of 2020, humanists are playing an established role in global politics in the West, with many of them even being elected to legislature within their respective states. For now, transhumanism just seems like a concept that may or may not be realized practically in the distant future, far beyond our lifetimes. But if you know where to look, you can see certain indications that may tell you that we are already moving forward in that direction. Human performance enhancement products already exist. In the V&A Museum of London recently, the U.S. company Cyborgs displayed powered clothing. This is worn under regular clothes, and it actually gives a discreet boost in strength. Primarily designed to help older people with simple tasks such as getting out of a chair or climbing stairs, it can really be worn and used by anyone. There are also medical and chemical advances that are made to help the weak or the elderly, but are often abused by athletes or the healthy to boost performance. A critical example of this is the drug erythropoietin, EPO, which boosts red blood cell production. More red blood cells naturally means more oxygen and therefore more energy. Originally, EPO was made to help patients with severe anemia, i.e. lack of red blood cells. It's also possible to get simple gadgets like carbon fiber blades, which are already used in Olympic sports. For now, they perform just as well as a normal human leg, of a runner, but scientists are confident that these carbon fiber blades will become so finely made that runners wearing them will outperform others easily. Companies are already spending their capital behind the development of enhancement technologies. A common and the most well-known example of this is the Google Glass, which is essentially a smartphone in the form of a wearable glass. Indeed, wearables will be one of the first types of human enhancement technology to see rapid development. Google Glass is essentially a very early blueprint of what wearable technology can be expected to reach. Scientists muse about the arrival of contact lenses that can capture pictures and videos, universal language translators in our ears that can make communication easier, and suits that greatly increase physical strength and speed. Physical implants will also greatly benefit from a transhumanism-focused development attitude. Leg replacement pillars for shattered or torn legs that work just as well as natural leg or even better than them could soon become a real thing. Development of mechanical replacements for some parts of the body, save for the vital organs, is a goal many scientists in the future are expected to want to target. The final area of human technological augmentation is entirely biological. As scientists learn more and more about our DNA and the human genome, they predict eventually being able to use IVF technology to select the most intelligent embryos. This, along with further development of CRISPR, gene editing technology, which may allow us to eliminate all heritable diseases, will be the most important factor in making transhumanism a successful human philosophy. It's quite clear that rapid leapfrog advances in the capability of human physiology is within reach at the current rate of technological advancement. The burning question that still remains is it ethically sound? When technology eventually reaches this level, will it be morally justifiable to allow surgeons to replace a person's limbs with carbon fiber pillars just for a boost in performance and capability? Many scientists and regular people are averse to this idea. As J.B.S. Haldane once put forth as a prediction, many people today think of body modifications and transhuman enhancement of the body with technology as a blasphemous act. Lay Whitby, an artificial intelligence expert at Sussex University, says, "I would have none of it. It is a repulsive idea to remove a healthy limb for transient gain." Of course, there are many proponents of the idea of transhumanism. Cybernetics expert Kevin Warwick, in a statement made to The Guardian, asked, "What is wrong with replacing imperfect bits of your body with artificial parts that will allow you to perform better, or which might allow you to live longer?" Despite what both sides of the argument put forth, what is objective truth is that the technology needed to achieve these goals relies on technology that will remain unrealized for a very long time. These technological developments being unrealized also means that some entrepreneurs and inventors are pushing the buttons on transhumanist technology to the fullest. Some of these entrepreneurs and inventors have banded together to back the idea of having bodies stored in liquid nitrogen and preserved. Their idea is to preserve as such until medical science has reached the stage where their bodies can be revived from cold encasement flawlessly. Four such cryogenic facilities containing chambers for preservation have been built. Built they have been, but whether or not they are just showpieces remains to be seen. However, another undeniable aspect to this that cannot be ignored is the sense of superiority. Society as it currently exists is quite divided on the basis of wealth, nationality, ethnicity, religion, and so on. Creating a class of cyborgs separated from normal human beings will only create another ground for division. While being engrossed in our fantasies about the possibilities that may be brought about by cybernetic enhancements to the human body, we tend to forget the important minor details that are very easy to miss. In case of parts malfunction leading to injury of other people, who is liable? The wearer or the manufacturer of the part? Indeed, the advent of viable human cybernetic organisms has the potential to pose many challenges, many of which are deeply uncomfortable. Despite this, optimism isn't hard to come by in this regard, as with all new forms of technology, initial concerns give way to later success and smooth sailing. Let us know in the comments below what you think of this. Do you think mankind should embrace the machinery-powered future to propel himself beyond all that's possible? Or do you think cyborgs should be restricted exclusively to the realm of science fiction? If you like this video, you may also enjoy our full playlist on Tesla that is shown in the end screen. And please subscribe to Futurephile to watch more fascinating videos on futuristic tech.